Welcome to Community Church at Ocean Pines. I'm Pastor Bob Harris, substituting today for Senior Pastor Dale Brand. I'm glad you chose to worship with us in these brief moments. Hear now these words from Psalm 111. The psalmist writes, "Praise the Lord. I thank the Lord with all my heart. The works of God are magnificent. God's deeds are majestic and glorious. God's righteousness stands forever. God is famous for God's wondrous works. God is full of mercy and compassion." Words of the psalmist in Psalm 111. Please join me as we pray. Creator God, you made us and you love us. Remind us that our circumstances do not define who we are. We're always your children. Whatever we choose to do today, you promise to guide us. We can do nothing without your strength. May we bring honor and glory to you in our worship and everything we do today. Guide our steps, Lord, to follow you. Amen. Here are the Bible reading for today. From Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 to 20. The Apostle Paul is writing, and the Apostle says, "Be careful how you walk, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of your time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, in which there is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your hearts to the Lord. Always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to our God and Father." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
My Father's ways bestowment, I've no cause.
was a very prosperous business executive. He had to travel quite frequently. He traveled so much, he decided to purchase his own airplane. George took flying lessons and was soon very comfortable and very efficient with his more convenient, faster means of transportation. After a few years, George decided to purchase a pontoon airplane so he could fly back and forth from his beautiful summer home, which was located on a lake. On his very first flight in his new pontoon airplane, George forgot and started to head for the local airport landing strip, just as he had always been doing. Luckily, his wife was with him and realized what he was doing. And she said to her husband, "George, pull up, pull up. You can't land this airplane on a runway. This airplane has pontoons, not wheels. Pull up, George." Looking flushed and flustered, George quickly hit the airplane throttle, pulled up, and headed off towards the lake. Landing safely and smoothly in the still blue water, George shook his head and said, "I do not know where my mind was. I just wasn't thinking. That's one of the dumbest things I have ever done." George then opened the door to the airplane and stepped right out into the lake. As he was splashing in the water, his wife heard him grumbling and mustering. "Are you like George? My mind works like that very frequently. Some people seem to have everything all together. They never get flustered, never commit a faux pas. They always know the right thing to say and the right thing to do and the right time to say it and do it. Then there are folks like me, those of us who step absentmindedly into a lake." Being absent-minded really means that we're preoccupied with great thoughts. Isn't that true? Albert Einstein was a bit absent-minded. He once used a $1,500 Rockefeller Foundation check as a bookmark and then lost the book. The next time you can't find your glasses or your car keys or something else for the 100th time, just tell everybody you're like Albert Einstein. The Apostle Paul today writes about how we are supposed to walk. He's not talking about being absent-minded. The Apostle Paul is talking to you and to me when he says, "Be careful how you walk. Walk as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil." What's the Apostle Paul mean when he says, "Be careful how we walk"? He goes on to give us this answer when he writes, "Do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit." In other words, we're to use our heads, use our minds, so we don't do anything that is stupid and literally mess up our lives. There are all kinds of foolishness. Some kind can be avoided, some cannot. An army colonel frowned impatiently as he watched a young lieutenant drill his platoon. Sweat beaded on the forehead of the young lieutenant. His voice became strained and raspy. The lieutenant was super nervous because he knew the colonel was watching, observing his every move. The lieutenant attempted to maneuver his men in an intricate procedure, but had the platoon marching instead directly towards the edge of a cliff. Completely rattled unnerved, the lieutenant froze, unable to speak. The colonel barked, "Good heavens, man, at least tell your men goodbye before they go over the cliff." I wonder how we are. Because of all the stress, strain, and lack of experience, perhaps this instance describes unavoidable foolishness. All of us can panic in a particular situation. There's the kind of foolishness which is avoidable. This consists of the little, stupid, silly things in our lives. Little things that so often lead to our downfall, to our defeat. Things we know we should change. Things we know we should make an adjustment. But somehow we just never get around to it. All these little things prevent us from being all that God has created us to be. Do you remember the Goodyear blimp named Columbia? This giant, 192 feet long helium blimp was punctured by a small radio controlled model airplane. The damage was too slight to cause a constant crash or an instant crash, but the hole was big enough to cause a constant loss of helium. That blimp could not function efficiently like it was designed to do. Now, some of us may be limping along through life, not functioning the way God has designed us to function. We have holes in our spiritual lives, which we try to ignore. And yet we know we have to face our problems and get them repaired. We know there are sins we need to confess and ask Jesus Christ for forgiveness. Mike Giaconelli describes living in a rural community, a community in which there were lots of cattle ranches. Frequently, he would see a lost cow alongside the road. After helping a rancher get his cow back onto his ranch, he asked the rancher, "Tell me, how do cows get themselves lost?" And the rancher explained, "Well, the cow starts nibbling on a tuft of green grass. When it finishes, it looks ahead to the next tuft of green grass, and then starts nibbling on that one. Then nibbles on a tuft of green grass right next to a hole in the fence. Then it sees another tuft of grass on the other side of the fence, and it goes there and begins to nibble on that one. And then on to the next tuft of green grass. The next thing you know," the rancher says, "the cow has nibbled itself into being lost." This is how you and I get lost from God. We commit one little sin, and later it's easier to commit the second. Then we commit the third, and then we commit the fourth. No one plans to become an alcoholic, or addicted to pain pills, or addicted to some drug, or addicted to some particular activity. We keep moving from one tuft of activity to another, never noticing how far we have gone from home or how far away from the truth we have already traveled. Before we wake up, we realize we have moved away from God. The Apostle Paul reminds us, be careful. Be careful how you walk. Understand what the will of the Lord is for each of our lives. We're to watch where we walk. We're to be wise, to use our heads. Paul reminds us to sing and to make melody with your hearts to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to our God and Father. So we're to worship. We're to sing. We're to make melody in our hearts. We're also to always give thanks to God in every situation. I haven't gotten there yet. This is a major, major challenge for me. I've not learned to give God thanks in every situation. Recently, our garage lost all electricity. The house was fine, but nothing in the garage worked. Garage door wouldn't go up and down. The freezer did not function. Naturally, no lights on in the garage. Frustrated, the electrician had a difficult time finding the source of the problem and getting it repaired. I'm spoiled. I'm used to touching a button and the garage door goes up just like magic. And I push another button and the garage door goes back down. For 3 or 4 weeks, I had to manually lift and close the garage door. Now that's not an earth-shattering problem, is it? I'm not sure what I was supposed to be thankful for in that particular situation. I am thankful to have a garage, and I'm thankful to have a garage door that works well when it has electricity. I'm thankful the electrician found what the problem was. The underground wire from the house to the garage had been chewed, he thinks probably by a mole. Now, I've not been able to thank God for that mole who cost me $300. John Killinger reminds us and writes about a man he knows named Ralph. Ralph is a graduate of Purdue University, an engineer, a businessman, a counselor, a friend with bubbling energy all the time. When you or I drop a pencil, the first thing we do is pick it up, right? Not Ralph. When Ralph drops a pencil, the first thing he does is look up and say, thank you. And then Ralph tries to figure out for what he is thankful. In the case of dropping a lead pencil, Ralph explains, the first thing I think about is how thankful I am for gravity. Without gravity, that pencil would not have fallen down where I could easily reach it and pick it up. Without gravity, the pencil would have disappeared way up there somewhere, and I would have lost it. Then he says, I thank God for graphite, because without graphite, there wouldn't be a lead pencil. Then I thank God for the trees from which the pencil was made. And then I thank God for the engineering that creates a pencil. And I especially thank God for the chemical engineering that made erasers so I can remove and clean up the mistakes I make. And Ralph goes on and does this, he says, in every situation, every experience. If his car tire is flat, he pulls over to the side of the road, looks upward and says, thank you. And he thinks the things for which he is thankful in that situation. Maybe he's thankful there was a wide space to which he could pull over safely, away from the whizzing cars going by the highway. Maybe he's thankful that only one tire is flat and not two or three. Maybe he's thankful that when he gets out of the car, he gets a chance to stretch and to release some of the aches in his body from arthritis. Ralph does this no matter what happens. Looks upward and says, thank you. And tries to think of something in that situation for which to give God thanks. Ralph says, if you can think of one or two reasons to be thankful, you're going to feel better. If you can think of 4 or 5 reasons to be thankful, you're going to feel a lot, lot better. Now, it's so easy to dismiss Ralph as an unrealistic Pollyanna. What's the alternative when something goes wrong, as they will go wrong? Do we curse our luck, fuss, fume, raise our blood pressure a few degrees? Do we shout, scream, and agitate our ulcer and give everybody else around us an ulcer also? Do we bottle up all this frustration in life until we have some kind of cardiac arrest? It'd be so much better if we could all do what Ralph does. Give thanks to God in every situation. Now, I haven't gotten there yet. I try to work on that in every situation. When I and when we learn to give thanks in every situation, life will go smoother and we might even live a little longer. Even if we don't live longer, we will enjoy more of the days and more of the time we already have. So Paul says, let's be careful how we walk. Amen. Here at the church, we appreciate all your offerings and contributions for all you do to make this church vibrant and alive and active. So please pray with me as we give God thanks for all these gifts. And every morning is your love, great God of light. And all day long you are working for good in the world. Use us and all our offerings to continue your good work. Through Jesus Christ, we pray.
Ready?
Says, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Go in peace, and may God always hold you in the palm of God's hand. Amen.